time now for our rants and raves of the week, starting with John.
So I have a rant for an article that appeared in the New York Post the other day, and I know what the New York Post is. I don't pick it up or click on it thinking I'm going to read, the New Republic. But here's a story about a homeless man who was spotted at a hot food bar in a Manhattan Whole Foods helping himself with his hands. I guess he must have been hungry. Sometimes that happens when you're homeless. Well, the article was a sneering, vile, really editorial screed masquerading as a news story, no less than three bylines, ridiculing this guy.
Really?
Here's an excerpt from the article. Quote, in the closest thing to a display of personal hygiene from the man, he stopped every now and then to lick his fingers clean.
Wow.
So, you know, maybe there's a story in this story about a lack of sanitary conditions at a Whole Foods. Maybe there's a story about homeless people running amok. Those are valid stories. Go ahead and do that story.
That's
Don't make an ass of yourself, and a vile ass at that, by writing something like this and publishing
it. I'm glad you did that. That was awful.
Yeah, I didn't even catch that. All right, Callie.
5 years ago, Sabrina Rubin Erdely wrote A Rape on Campus in Rolling Stone. You know, that seems like a light years away now in the light of Me Too. And so this is a really interesting article by The Guardian talking about the lessons learned.
Is this a rave?
I'm sorry. This is a rave for this article because they really did a deep dive on lessons learned for coverage of these kinds of stories and also really examining, you know, what her responsibility was as a journalist in that mix and how she fell short. And now looking at some of the current ways we have covered it and what journalists are going beyond, way beyond what she did, just to make certain that these stories don't fall apart in this way or accuse people.
She hasn't come out of the penalty box.
No, they said that her social media is kind of frozen from back in the
time.
From
5 years ago.
Yeah.
What was one of the lessons learned?
That you need to, we knew this before, but you need to talk to everybody first, who say they were allegedly there, and then find out, not afterwards find out, you know, she mentioned me, but I wasn't actually there. And I don't know what she's talking about. So-and-so didn't come talk to me. Yeah. I mean, there were some basic kinds of
calling people implicated in the story.
Wow. Absolutely. Yeah.
All right, Jennifer.
So I have a rave for the Washington Post, an article by Christopher Ingraham about how the media gets it wrong when it covers rural America. And he says in this article that the media has this newfound obsession with rural America because most journalists believe these are the Trump voters and we need to figure out why they think the way they do. But then they go and make a mess out of it in the way they cover it. For example, he says, most media, when they talk about rural America, are talking about the Midwest. But in fact, rural America is everywhere, right? So Maine has rural America, New York has rural America. But a lot of journalists conflate that with Midwestern. They also often assume that rural Americans are white truck drivers who eat at these little diners, when in fact, you know, large portions of Native American tribes that's rural America.
And black people.
Right.
Right. Native Americans live there.
Yeah. Well, okay, right. So he says in the article, I think it's 22 or 23% of rural America are people of color, and that story is completely missed. So I thought it was a great piece.
Good. Dan.
I have a rave for the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court, which this week overturned a ruling by the Massachusetts Appeals Court that had said that a student newspaper at UMass Boston was not free to report on the publicly available police log. The Supreme Judicial Court said, oh, yes, they are. They restored these what's called the fair report privilege. And it's not 100%, but it's a logical protection for any reporter trying to report on what's going on with regard to
this kid had just
police.
Taken something out of a police blotter, which turned out to be not accurate, but that's where he got it from.
Well, that's right. That's right. Yeah. And you can't report anonymous rumors, but but official police actions are completely protected.
All right, well, finally tonight, I have a rave for, I didn't know there was a Vogue Italia, but my rave is for Vogue Italia, which it's kind of a gimmick what they did, but it's clever at the same time. No photo shoots, no travel, no cars. Usually one of these glossies is hundreds of thousands of dollars to just on location shooting and all that. So they did all of the fashion designs in paintings, sketches, drawings. I mean, some of them were really highly stylistic, but it was real clothing all through the magazine. The covers are obviously interesting in itself, but and they were used real, they actually had models that they painted the clothing in, but you could see it was rather abstract, but clever.
That's not going to come to my business, is it? I mean, I don't think there's an artist sick enough to draw me.
The photographer's
all right,
take
that is it
hit.
For our show. Tell us what you think. Email us, tweet us, send us a comment. We're always on at beatthepress.org.